Welcome to the second lecture of the course Engineering Mechanics ESME 301. In our last lecture we have discussed the importance of the subject Engineering Mechanics. What are the classification of Engineering Mechanics, that means statics and dynamics? What are the applications of Engineering Mechanics? Why the subject Engineering Mechanics is well accepted and very much important to all aspects in our day-to-day life, in our real-time problem. And what is the approach of classical mechanics or Newtonian mechanics? You have studied particle mechanics. What is the basis of particle mechanics? Why we will assume a body as a particle, a point mass? What is force? The force system is we have not yet studied. We will study in our next lecture. What is force system or force family? We also studied scalar, vector, the basics of that. In details, we will study later on. Today we will study the second lecture of the first chapter, Introduction to Engineering Mechanics. And the content of today's lecture, the overview, is to study the principles or the laws of mechanics. There are mainly six laws. The first law is basically dealing with the polygon law of forces. One is polygon law, one is triangle law, one is parallelogram law. Actually, all the laws are same. We'll see later on how from one law to another law we can approach. The next is the law or the principle of transmissibility, which we have already studied in our last lecture. That is one force. If the force is acting on a rigid body, not a deformable body, then that force vector we can assume as a sliding vector. And we know a sliding vector can shift along this line of action and its point of application may vary. But in doing so, the effect of the force, just the external effect of the force on their body, will not be changed. So this is the law of transmissibility of force. And 3, 4 and 5 are Newton's law. Newton's first law, second law and third law, which we have already studied in class 11, 12. And the last one is Newton's law of gravitation. That means two mass in the universe always attract each other, whatever their mass may be. Say sun and moon, moon and earth, sun and earth. So let us go one by one. The first law of Engineering Mechanics is the polygon law. Now there are three laws actually: parallelogram law, triangle law and polygon law. In the parallelogram law, it is told that if two vectors or two forces A and B, if two forces A and B can be represented by two vectors like this, two free vector. Free vector means they can easily be moved or replaced or displaced from one place to another place. Say it is a XY plot. say here is a vector, say F. If I want to replace this force, so I can replace it here. The effect should not be changed. I can replace it here. I can replace it here. Assuming that the body, the same body is here, or here, or here, or here. So the effect should not be changed. These types of vectors are called free vectors. Now, the resultant force. What is the resultant force? First, we have to discuss. The resultant force of a number of forces. So there are 1, 2, 3, n number of vectors. If those n number of vectors can be replaced by a single vector, then how to replace? Replacing such a way that the net effect produced by all those n forces on the body and the effect of the replaced force on the same body is same without altering the effect. Then only those n number of forces can be equivalently replaced by a single force. Such type of force, equivalent force, is called resultant force. Here, there are two forces, A and B, are shown as shown in the first diagram. If these two forces are to be replaced by equivalent force or resultant force R, that means R is such a force which is the resultant force of A and B. So it is the vector sum of A and B. So not only the direction or the position is equivalent, at the same time the effect is also equivalent. Now if A and B, these two forces or these two vectors, can be replaced by two adjacent sides of a parallelogram, then the diagonal of the parallelogram passing through the point of intersection of those two forces or those two vectors represents the resultant force or the equivalent force of those two forces or vectors. Now, in this, if this A and B, how to draw? So draw a parallel line through point B and draw a parallel line through point A. This is parallel to vector B. So as this B is a free vector, I can replace it here. As A is also a free vector, I can replace it here without changing its sign or its effect. Now there are two diagonal. One is O to, say it is C, OC, and is AB. There are two diagonals. Now the equivalent force or the resultant force of A and B will pass through the point of intersection of A and B. That means OC will be the resultant force R. Is clear? So this is the parallelogram law. Next is the triangle law. The triangle law states that if two forces acting simultaneously at a point, say force F1 and force F2, these two forces are acting simultaneously at the same time. These two forces are acting at a point O, as shown in the diagram. If the two sides OA, say it is A, and OB can be represented by those two forces, F1 and F2, passing through the 0.0, and if we take F1 and F2 in same order, same order means continuous order. Say this is a force F1, this is a force F1, a vector F1. Continuous means you have to, since here both F1 and F2 are free vector, so I can either draw the force F2 here, or I can replace it here, a parallel force of F2. Now, taken in same order, that means there is a continuity in the direction. The direction of F1 is from O to A, and the direction of F2 is from A to B. If the two forces are taken in same order, and these are considered to be the two adjacent sides of a triangle, then the third side or the left side of the triangle taken in opposite order, not in the same order of F1 and F2, taken in opposite order, that means OB, will be the equivalent force or the resultant force of F1 and F2. So, if two forces acting simultaneously at a given point be represented in magnitude and direction by two adjacent sides of a triangle taken in same order, either clockwise or anti-clockwise, then the resultant force is represented in magnitude and direction by the third side or the left side of the triangle taken in opposite order. This is very important. Opposite order. They are in same order. If it is, say, anti-clockwise order, it will be a clockwise order. And the resultant force is given by root over F1 square plus root over F2 square plus 2F1 F2 cos theta. Where theta is the angle between these two forces. This we have already started in class 11-12. So the laws of the resultant force. So the triangle law just now we have studied. There is another law which is called the polygon forces. The polygon law of forces, the triangle law of forces we have already studied. The polygon law of forces tells that, which is the extension of the triangle law of forces. And here the number of forces are should be more than two, obviously. The number of forces will be more than two. Say there is a polygon. Say if a number of forces can be represented by the adjacent sides or the continuous sides of a polygon. It is A, it is B, it is C, it is D, it is E, like this. Then the equivalent force or the resultant force of all these forces, the n number of forces, will be the last side or the joining side of the polygon taken in opposite order. So from the initial point to the final point, this vector will be the resultant force of all other forces. So this is the polygon law. If a number of forces acting simultaneously on a particle be represented in magnitude and direction by the sides of a polygon taken in order, then the resultant force of all these forces may be represented in magnitude and direction by the closing size of the polygon, which is taken in opposite order. So this last line is very important, taken in opposite order. Yeah. So this is the polygon law, which is the extension of the triangle law of forces. Here, there are a number of forces, and the first condition is the number of forces must be more than two. Here we have taken how many forces? Four forces, A, B, C, and D. So we have to find such a force, which is the resultant force or the equivalent force of vector A, B, C, and D, the force A, B, C, and D, so that the resultant force R can be equivalently replaced by A, B, C, and D. Here, you can see, this is the vector A, O to A. The vector B is A to B. Vector C is B to C. And vector D is C to D. Now, what is the initial point of the from where we have started? It is point A, point O. And what is the final point? Is point D. So, what is the closing side of the triangle? Of the polygon, O to D. So this O D vector taken in opposite order, because up to point D, from starting from point O, we have taken all the forces in anti-clockwise direction. So the closing side should be in clockwise direction in order to get the resultant force. Now the question is how this last force becomes the resultant force of all the forces represented by the adjacent sides of the polygon. Okay. Now, applying the earlier law, that means the triangle law of forces, we can see in the first, we have to join O to B. Now, if in the triangle OAB, you can see vector A is replaced by OA, vector B is replaced by OB, and the vector A and B are represented by two adjacent sides of a triangle and taken in same order. So the third side of the triangle taken in opposite order will be the resultant force of A and B. So if I have to replace A and B, I can replace by the vector OB. When we are writing the vector OB, then we cannot write the vector OA and AB. Second, in the second triangle here, the vector A plus B, or the resultant of AB, that means the vector O to B, and the vector B to C are taken in same order. Then obviously the third side of the triangle, or the closing side of the triangle, in opposite order, will be A plus B plus C, the vector sum. So when we are writing A plus B plus C, we cannot write A plus B and C. And then in the third triangle, again, A plus B plus C and D are taken in same order. So the last side will be A plus B plus C plus D, taken in opposite order. So from the triangle law, by using the triangle law, we can justify the polygon law of forces. The principle of transmissibility we have already studied in the last class. We have seen that a same body of same mass, say M, but two different cases. The first case, the force F is applied here. And in the second case, the force is applied here. If the body is a rigid body, then there is no difference in the external effect of the first case and the second case. The effect, the same force F, same mass body M, is same if the body is a rigid body. Because for a rigid body, a force is a sliding vector. But if the body is a deformable body or non-rigid body, then the external resultant effect on case one and case two will not be same. Why? Because for the first body, it may be push. For the second body, it may be pull. Say here is a body, which is a deformable body. If we apply a push here on this point, maybe this portion will get deformed or will tend to deform. But if we apply the same force here, instead of the first point one, if we apply at point two here, we will see that the deformation will be at point two as well as at point one. Say, so the deflection or the deformation of the body will not be as same as it was in for point one. So the external effect, because in the case of rigid body, we know that the effect remains same. So the effect of the force on the applied body or on the body on which it is applied is now changed. So for a deformable body, we cannot apply or we cannot assume the applied force to be a sliding pattern. But for a principle of transmissibility, which is only for the concept of an ideally rigid body, is only for rigid bodies. So for rigid body, we can slide the force along this line of action, and the point of application may be anywhere on the line of action, within anywhere on the body. Okay, or it may outside the body also. Because for a rigid body, if the force magnitude is same, the line of action is same, the effect is same, irrespective of its pull or push. So a force may be applied at any point for a rigid body on its given line of action without altering the resultant external effects on the body on which the force is acting. Say, here are the examples, few examples. Here, these two forces, F1 and F2, if they are extended, they will join at a point. So these two types of forces are called concurrent forces. These two lines are parallel lines. Say one is F1, one is F2. These two forces are parallel forces. But one force, this is F1, and another force, F2, they will intersect if you extend. So these two forces are the intersecting forces. Here these two forces are non-intersecting forces. Say any two parallel forces are non-intersecting forces, because they will never meet, or they will meet at the infinite, after infinite distance. The two railway tracks. Okay. Now non-concurrent forces. Now, if F1 and F2 are two forces, concurrent forces, they will meet at a point. Now, if two forces are passing through one point, these are also concurrent. At the same time, two forces, they are trying to meet at one point, these types of forces are also concurrent. Now, what are the effects of, so, or what are the resultant force? How to find out? So this is the direction of F1 as per the first diagram. And this is the direction of F2. So what to do? This F2, you can replace, so like this, by sliding this. So the third side of the triangle will give you the resultant force of F1 and F2. This is shown here. The study of rigid body mechanics is formulated on the basis of Newton's law of motion. So Newton's first law, second law, and third law. What is Newton's first law? An object at rest tends to stay at rest, and an object in motion tends to continue its motion with the same speed or same velocity and the same direction until and unless acted upon by an external disturbance or agency. This external agency or this unbalancing external agency is called force. So Newton's first law is the qualitative law of force. What is force? That answer, the definition of the force is given by Newton's first law. Force is an external agent or is a some sort of unbalanced agent which when acted upon a body changes or tends to change the state of rest or the motion of that particle or the body. If the body was at rest after the application of that unbalanced external agency or the force, the state of rest either will be changed or tends to be changed. If the body is moving at uniform speed at a given direction, until and unless some external force is applied, the body will continue that speed and that direction. So this is the first law of mechanics. So the sum of the net force, the sum of the net force in a particular direction is always zero. Actually, it is a null vector. And it is the all types of forces, all types, all possible types of forces. Now here, in the case of the summation of F, here it comes, some forces are applied, some are reactive. Okay, so the sum of applied forces, the sum of applied forces and the reactive forces. So the sum of active forces, action and reaction, are zero. So this also gives us the idea of Newton's third law. We know that if we apply a force P on a body, the body due to its inertia, due to its mass or due to its property will exert equal and opposite force P. Whether the body can withstand the load or not, it is a separate thing. It is under strength of material. But the body tries to react against the applied force.
the reaction. So if this is P in the positive X direction, so obviously the reactive force is minus P. So what you can write? P minus P is zero, the net force is zero. Whatever we feel during an accident or during a collision is nothing but the reactive force or the reaction. We feel the reaction force only. So action don't count. Action is what we strike. What are the force we used to impose on the body which has given the reaction? If that force is P, we have got minus P. So ultimately, there is null force in equilibrium. The second law of Newton is given by F is equal to ma. The applied force is mass times acceleration. So it is the qualitative law of force. And according to this force, the rate of change of momentum, the rate of change of momentum of a particle or a body is directly proportional to the force applied. Now, if we consider that the particle is having a constant mass, then we can write m dv dt, that means A, so m into A is the force. So the applied force is the product of the mass, which is the amount of inertia as per the first law. The first law is a qualitative law, and it tells that the mass of a body is the amount of inertia which the body or the particle possesses, and it is the resistance to motion. In case of dynamics, in case of statics, mass is the amount of, or is the measure of, the attraction forces that another particle feels for the virtue of mass. Newton's third law is the every force is having a equal and opposite reaction. So it is the law of action reaction. If action is plus F, reaction is minus F, like this. Now, what we actually feel, we used to apply the force F in this direction. If this is plus F, we will feel minus F. And this F, the reaction, is offered by the resisting wall of the body. Whatever we feel the pain or we feel the force is purely the reaction. Now, the last law, the Newton's law of gravitation, it tells that if two masses, capital M and small m, is kept apart at a distance r, then the force, the attraction force, which is felt by both m and m, both these forces, say one is moon, one is say earth, whatever, any two object in the universe, is given by g into m1 and m2 by r square, where r is the distance between the particles and meter, m and m are the masses of the two particles, g is the universal constant of gravitation or gravitational constant. This is 6.673 into 10 to the power minus 11. So this amount of force is being attracted due to the amount of mass. Say this is the mass of Earth, capital M, and the mass of Moon is small m. What is the attraction force that Moon is feeling due to Earth, so that the Moon can not break the axis or its rotational axis or its rotational path due to this attraction force. Due to the gravitational force G, which is 9.81 meter per second square. Now, what is G? G is actually what is G? If you drop a particle from a height what is the speed what is the speed of the particle to come from that point to the Earth surface in a given time? Say the time required is t and the velocity attained near the Earth surface is v, so it is v by t. So what is the change in velocity in a given time? What is the change in velocity in a given time? A change in velocity is given by meter per second. And time is given by second, so meter per second square. Or 32.2 feet per second square. So this 9.81 meter square is not only for the universe, it is only for the near the sea level. It will change in other atmospheres. It will change along with the distance. It will change in other planets. So thank you for today. In our next lecture, we would like to introduce the free body diagram. What is a free body diagram? How to draw it? What are the importance of drawing a free body diagram? What are the assumptions? What are the techniques? What are the methods? What to remember during the drawing of a free body diagram? These things we will study in our next class. Thank you.